Press the bell icon on YouTube and don't miss another update.
This health and education being areas which are largely, or not largely, which are government focus areas, what have you kind of, what business opportunities you have sensed, and how has been your interaction with the state or the establishment, the government? What kind of new things that you get to know about that?
Sure. Being someone who's a non-government organization, our first instinct obviously was not to work that closely with the government, primarily because we were very clear we didn't want to take any money from them for multiple reasons in India which just don't work there. So we were quite happy to work on our own. I think the first 2-3 years we did pretty well on that, but we realized that to really scale anything in the not-for-profit space, you do need the government to be a partner. And I can tell you that during those 3 years, our interaction with the government at the ground level was quite incredible, because we believe that they come there and be more of a hindrance. But the people who are working on the ground have got the highest level of motivation for what you want to do. And anecdotally, one of the first visits we had was to a hospital with 100 beds in government hospital in Raigad. And the lady there, who was the head of the hospital, had actually had a 1-year-old kid that she had left behind in a place 200 kilometers away, but wanted to work in this sector. And all she told us is, look, I've got this 100 bed and only 2 or 3 patients I get at any given time. And we're saying, but we've got a lot of health issues outside, which is why we went to visit her. And she said, there's only one gap, and the word is trust. So if you as a not-for-profit and an NGO can build trust between the community and the government and be a catalyst. And I think it resonated with us very strongly at that time, because when we were entering that geography also, people looking at doing something in the social sector, you think it's a given that if you want to do something good, the other person is absolutely ready to accept it, which is not really true. You have to build an incredible amount of trust in what you want to do.
In terms of, say, education, when you say that, or even in health, when you said that there was very little trust between people and the government, quoting the hospital thing, so what, in education, what you find are areas where, you know, you as a for-profit venture can change?
In the education space, the reality is that most people have started working at a very young age, meaning mostly after graduation, forget post-graduation, or sometimes at the 12th standard, and now are stuck in their careers. So they're stuck for 2-3 reasons, because one, you know that there are people coming in younger than you that are overtaking you. Number two, you can't get out of that job to take a year off to study because you don't know what that is, and the opportunity cost and the cost is too high. And third, we don't have really the faculty and the teaching skills in this country yet at that level for us to be able to penetrate. So for me, the most non-linear thinking in education was to focus on the working professional and to focus on online. Now, online for most people is suspect and a little bit of a raised eyebrows and a little disdainful thing. Yeah, but online, because most people relate online to content. Okay, I'll look at something like a TED talk and I'll learn something. No. How do you make online into equivalent to a learning experience? And I think that's been the major focus, that if you can, for India and countries like India, the next big wave has to be the online way in which we're going to learn. Because then you can take the best of faculty, put them into an environment. You can take the training to a completely different level and your learning experience can be high. So we've been very, very non-linear in UpGrad to focus on the learning experience more than the content.
So to some extent, you know, it kind of complements with the skill development, which is at the lower end of the spectrum then, and this is at the mid-career, so to say?
Yes, except that I have a slight bit of a problem with the word skills, because it kind of down-markets everything that we do. And I think we need to find a different word for the word skills. As much as I think we need to find a different vocabulary for the word philanthropy in India, because I think it's too, the younger generation can't relate to that, and we need the younger generation to come in there. The same way, I think skills for most people sounds very basic. And I think if we want to create a country which is going to be more driven by intellectual property and innovation and thought leadership versus being a permanent outsourcing arbitrage country, I think we'll have to use a word better than skills.
Why do we see Indian entrepreneurs not, I mean, what stops them from taking their company to the next level and exiting midway? I mean, a lot of companies we see, unlike in US and other countries, where they take it to the next level and they are really global companies. What stops Indian entrepreneurs to take their companies to the next level?
I think we've been too obsessed with the concept of control. This 51% shareholding and this control element, that it's my company. Now, the main point is, yes, at 100%, it's your company. At 99%, it stops being your company. And anything after that, it should stop being your company. And you should be able to differentiate between being a shareholder or an investor or a CEO and managing director. And we don't do that. So that obsession for control sometimes leads you into taking decisions that are much more, I wouldn't say myopic, but limited. And I think that's the one part of the scale. And I think the other one is we have everything as a glass ceiling. But the reason it's called a glass ceiling is for you to break it. And it takes a lot to punch it and break it because you're going to bleed at the time at which you break a glass ceiling. And I think that element here is that everyone comes to a market size and then we reach a glass ceiling, which in India is the case. Because either it's price sensitive or it's volume sensitive or it's territorial, geographical sensitive, south versus north versus east versus west. And at that stage, you have to be able to break that glass ceiling. And I think most of us, the temperament here, having seen the older business groups diversify horizontally, the mental mindset is, oh, we should diversify versus let's go stronger on a vertical. And I think if we can change these two mindsets, a lot can change.
You're one of the biggest film and television producers in the country, but you're an outsider in the sense that most of them all come from families which had a foothold within the industry. Was it a big handicap? I mean, how do you get it?
So, and just to clarify, after 2012, I'm pretty much out of the media and entertainment business. But to answer your question very specifically, yes, I was the outsider. And first, I'll give you the monosyllabic answers and then I'll give you the longer answer. Yes, I was an outsider and no, it wasn't a handicap. And to me, it was a blessing in disguise, meaning it was a handicap in the sense that one couldn't penetrate that thought process. But because I was the outsider, it challenged me even more. Because I think if I did what everybody else was doing, I would have done a lousy job at it.
I think you spoke about entrepreneurship in the beginning. I just wanted to ask about your community. I mean, they were a pioneer in entrepreneurship, philanthropy. But I don't think, I mean, apart from you or Cyrus Poonawalla, you know, of Serum Institute, I don't think, I mean, there's been a real sort of a demise of Parsi entrepreneurship. I mean, what is your take on this?
Well, our population is also shrinking of Parsis. You know, we're about 65,000 overall and it's shrinking because we don't allow cross marriage and things like that. So, I mean, I don't have an immediate answer for that.
A country like Bangladesh has had several social entrepreneurs.
You know? Yes.
You see, here we have a sort of a thing, you know, business, then CSR, philanthropy. Whereas you have many real, very large scale social enterprises, you know, like a social marketing company, which I think did a lot of work in contraception, BRAC, diarrhea, and you know, the sanitation, then Grameen Bank.
Yeah.
Why don't we have these kind of, you know, large scale? And we know that Bangladesh, a lot of their achievements has come because of the, whatever you can call it, NGO sector or
yes.
something, but which are some kind of a sort of a pragmatic, very social entrepreneur and very large scale. Whereas we have maybe an Arvind Eye Hospital here, and
yeah.
there, but why is it?
I just like to say for a lot of people, because in entrepreneurship, we get mixed up here. Either you're a not-for-profit or you're a for-profit. I personally am not a strong belief that you should be having a second compartment called for less profit. Because I think that confuses entrepreneurs, confuses vision, confuses people who want to put in money. And I think today the social sector here is suffering a little bit from people who want to create impact and therefore feel, I want to do it for less profit, which there isn't anything. Because if you do it for less profit, you're doing neither. In a country like India, everything we need to do, we need to solve problems at scale. Problems will be there a lot. But if you don't solve problems at scale, so when we looked at Swadesh, when I said a million people is because if I make a model of two villages, it'll be a nice anecdote. If I make it for 2,200 villages and a million people, it's an example that can follow. It's a model that I can create. So here today, I think everyone gets mixed up and BRAC had that vision of scale. Professor Yunus, when he wanted to do that, he wanted to do it at scale. The same example I give you for a micro housing finance company that I invested in and three very savvy entrepreneurs. And the first two meetings I had with them before I was investing in them. And they said, look, here's what we're doing. And they were giving, obviously, you know, it was a, market financing. So it was giving it out for housing for obviously less interest. And my first question to them is, do you want to give out 10,000 loans this year at a low interest of 11%? Or do you want to give a million loans to people who can't avail of a loan? The auto rickshaw guy, the people who don't have a chalan, they were just about getting the Aadhaar card, but at a slightly higher interest of 14%. Because at that stage, and I think the answer was no, we're looking at the 10,000. I said, that's the flaw. Because really, let's do a million people at 14% versus 10,000 people at 11%. because actually they don't mind paying the 3% more, because it's either I won't get a loan to do anything I want to do versus. So that's thinking, I think, in this part of the world, and especially in India, needs to change. And I'm a strong evangelist of that, that let's do something. If you're doing it for profit, then do it for profit, but do it at scale. Don't do a 50-bed hospital and say, I'm going to, all my beds are subsidized, because then nobody will give you the next 500 crores to build 50 hospitals. Then you'll be stuck at that one hospital. And that again is a part of your question of why can't we look at things where you build a 50-bed hospital, why can't you have 25 more such hospitals across?
So you have bagged several big-ticket films, and then like Puri as well. When I was speaking with Aditya, he said all credit goes to you because you had the conviction in the story. So what goes inside the mind of a producer, say your mind, when you have to pick a project and to back it accordingly, considering today all these small budget films are actually ruling, apart from the content part. So what goes inside your mind when you have to make that choice?
So I think the word back is the first word that I'd like to, because if you're looking at it as a producer, as just being a financier, then it's back and then nothing goes into that. Then it just becomes a sort of a viable project. So I think from day one, my DNA has been to be a creative, first creative, and then the rest comes out. The production came about because I wanted to be in control of the whole value chain. But at first and foremost is creative. So for me, actually understanding the script and relating to it, and is it a story I want to tell? Let's not make the mistake between saying I'm the target audience for that. Because if you do things based on you being the target audience for that, you're going to make 10 mistakes. But I think what my 15 years in media taught me was understanding consumers and understanding trends before they were happening and preempting trends. If there were the two big assets that I would take out of my learning in the media industry, outside of building a brand and building scale, these two were that. So when you finally take a call on a script, we call it a gut sense. But actually, gut is not waking up in the morning and saying, chalo, I'll do this. Gut is a lot of experience and a lot of failures that allow you to hone your judgment in a very different manner, and then you apply your gut. So I think when we look at our scripts, first and foremost is it's my evolved gut, I would call it, because there's no such thing as gut on a standalone basis. Second, a story I think I want to tell. And then we do a fair amount of research and focus groups. So it's not one of those things again. For all of these, we do a lot of focus groups, we do a lot of research. We're constantly in touch with consumers. Then you may still get it wrong 4 out of 10 times, which is a good enough average.
So what is that one, probably the biggest change you have noticed in the in the consumers or your audience?
I think in the last 2, 3, 4 years, people want to have context and a little bit of reality. So the fact that I'm learning something while I'm being entertained, if you take out the entertainment, it won't work. And I think people are saying, if you take out the context and just give me only suspension of reality, that's also not working. So the change that has happened is entertainment with suspension of reality versus now entertainment with a context.
Now we've seen a spate of films. Woody is the most popular and I would say the most well-made among them, which deal with contemporary political issues. Woody is made very soon before the election. You have Toilet Aid, Prem Katha, you have a host of these other films. How do you see that playing out? You know, this sort of, where is the line, where does that shift into being propaganda and what is the danger of that? Because it is a, the government of the day in a film like that from 0 to 30 onwards is shown in a certain light. And that is a danger between entertainment crossing over, especially because it's not like Border, which happens historically.
Yeah, so I'd like to say that, and especially since it's a media house, even more pertinent for me to say that. I don't see it as propaganda at all, and I can say it with an absolutely clean conscience. Firstly, when we decided to do it, this script was floating around for a year, year and a half. It had got nothing to do with the elections under any circumstances. It happened to do with the fact that the director and the writer who had written it had got nobody backing it. He gave it to me. I was going on a plane ride. I got out at the end of the plane ride and said, we're doing this movie because of the story, number one. Number two, the connection of saying it had anything to do with the elections, because movies take a year to make. They're not made, you know, so somebody can't say, oh, there was an attack day before yesterday. Can you give me a movie in 60 days? We've got state elections coming out now, so please can you do that? It doesn't work that way. I can only speak firsthand as far as Uri is concerned.
Your love for Square Code, but I think the first original Hindi film to premiere on Netflix. So was it a risk then, or is it a trend that you spotted earlier?
So if you look at that context, and Vicky Kaushal at that stage was still very nascent. So it was a lovely story, and I just felt at that stage, when I spoke to the Netflix guys, they said, we want, India is an important market. And I said, we want an important market, tell stories from here, and here's a movie. So I think it happened partly opportunistically and partly post. There is nothing we created for Netflix. It was a movie that was going to go on theatrical. I just felt it was a better platform putting on commerce and creative and doing it.
Another thing, as an entrepreneur, do you see that, I mean, one complaint that I usually get is that Indian market is 100 million.
For?
Generally, the people with purchasing power, which have all the startups, are looking at that. We may look like a huge population, but it's effectively a 100 million market.
Yeah.
It's not even closer to American market. So, have you plateaued, or do you think there is scope for it, that thin margins to do, even for assuming that all 400 million are a market right now?
I think
do
so.
You have to wait?
No, I think to the point I mentioned a little earlier, which is the concept of glass ceilings. You can look at any industry and sector and look at the glass ceiling, and then you have to figure out how high is your glass ceiling and what do you want to do, whether you want to diversify or what do you want to penetrate. Because the people who do break the glass ceiling are going to be big time winners, but it'll be a longer term view on things and requires a lot more courage, a lot more guts, and mostly the courage to stick it out. Because the minute you go there and up there and you're creating a market, it's tough. You may need funding, you may need 3 years of everyone poking fun at you saying, what the hell are you doing? You're in a wrong sector. Because most people think, why don't I diversify? But I think there's absolute treasure in that. There's absolute merit in that. And the question is, what's going to happen first? The people who break the glass ceilings, or 100 million market that's going to suddenly become a 400 million market overnight? Not going to happen. Now, the price push that e-commerce, for example, is just one demonstrativeness that's been able to do, is that we all thought in India, people won't buy online. Everyone wants to touch and feel. But now at scale, it's got changed. But you started with credible products where touch and feel was not most important. Fashion came much later, but products which you felt, okay, it's a branded product, whether I get it from my shop or I get it here, it'll come the same way. And the price point and the discount, you know, billions of dollars have been poured into discount, but at least it's opened up consumer trend to make a market that could have been 30 million, but is now coming to 100 million. So if 30 can get to 100, 100 can get to 400. That's something that we need to push on.
Sir, last year a number of people in the industry, powerful men, were accused of sexual harassment. In your opinion, what are the systems of redressal that can be put in place, especially given that the entertainment industry really functions on personal relationships, where, you know, who you know matters a lot to what you will do, whether you will get any work at all?
I can't speak on behalf of the entertainment industry, to be honest, because genuinely I don't represent it.
Sir.
Yeah, I don't represent it anymore. But I would think this is not a segment or a sector prevalent one. I think anywhere where you feel you have a leverage into a situation, there'll always be the ability to take advantage. So we have to figure that part out. And I think that can happen in a job relationship. It can happen in a political relationship. It can happen anywhere in that context. So it is a reality that needs to be dealt with. I think it requires a lot more mature handling. At corporates, it requires a very different mature handling. But I think, I mean, it's not a very India problem as much as it's a global problem. But the best part, I think, and some of the positive aspects of media bringing it out versus some of the things that media brings out, which are not so great, is the fact that it's out there in the open. So it's a little bit like failure is a tag for entrepreneurs to not become an entrepreneur. I think the fact that now it can be in such a public domain is a major, at least the first step towards people feeling, I need to be a little bit more mature, I need to be a little bit more accountable, and things are not just going to go where I can have a straightforward relationship. And it's happened at the President of the United States level, and it's happened even at a very incognito level. So I think it's out there in the open. It's not something that can now be hushed up at any stage.
Ronnie, one of the things which, you know, some talk about it, since you are a businessman, is about, you know, the large economic slowdown that we are seeing now, which has come down to 5% stuff. It's also because the industry as such has catered to a very small clientele, which is what Ravish talked about, say 100 million or 200 million. And they have not really created products, services for a swath of population that we have. So do you think that the slowdown which we are talking about, which some say is structural, could be some part because of this?
I mean, I can say in the education business where we're really scaling up, I've not seen a sense of a slowdown. But if you have, for example, right now, the biggest flogging horse there is the automobile sector. But if you look at that, what has happened is the amount of capex people have put in because of the massive competition, then the pressure on the entire context of an e-car and the whole electronic car context, you put it all together and then you don't see a growth level expansion that everyone thought this market would be, is a virtuous circle that has happened there. And I think whether we like it or not, the debt the debt over leveraging of entrepreneurs and founders and promoters in this country, of using capital from debt equivalent to equity, has actually created a very deep-seated thing. We can call it whichever we want to do there. Intentional or unintentional, some of them have obviously been black sheep and have misused it. Some have done it because businesses haven't worked. But that whole matching your vision with debt just doesn't add up. Just does not add up. You cannot have that kind of a vision and then not put your money where your mouth is. And you feel you're going to build it only through debt. I think that is the capitalist system in the country that is a little flawed, that you have this bigger vision, but 90% of that will come through capital that I don't need to feel obliged to repay. That's a mindset that has to just go away from the Indian ecosystem.
In the absence of something like a BARC or box office numbers, TRPs, how do you tell like your film Love Per Square Foot or say, like we heard Made in Heaven did very well, but there are no numbers to tell, the companies haven't come forward, there's no comparative data. How do you tell if a show or a film has done well?
So I think from a content creator's point of view, the best benchmark is if they're giving you a season two or they're continuing to do business with you. That's a simple benchmark. And if they're increasing your price for the next season. I think from the platform's point of view, it's a competitive environment. And I think they're not disclosing numbers, but they're obviously taking their business decisions on growth and renewing it in a very different manner. So just because the information is not public doesn't mean both ecosystems are not comfortable with their benchmarks. For content, it's renewal, and for them, it's a subscription model.
Looking at the upgrade data that you may have access to, that you have about Indian education sector, I mean, can you just throw geographical patterns or a kind of courses people are reading and some insights which only you may have access to or came as a revelation to you about Indian education?
I think people are questioning big time today, is an MBA relevant? Not in a bad way, but actually in a good way. And that MBA stands for three alphabets, but what does that get me? Because for most people, education is road to job. And I think the big thing here that we all need to fix is, of course, the end result is your working professional life, but it can't be that, because now you need a much more holistic approach to your learning process than only road to job. Because road to job doesn't mean retained in a job. That's your next big challenge. So road to job is one quick fix, and then retained to job means 3 years later you could be redundant. 3 years later, not 10 years later, not 15 years later. At the same time, I think the younger generation is flawed in their thinking that every 2 years I need to change a job. You need to have a certain sense of learning, and you're going to learn within an organization, because that is, if you're learning on the job and not learning from education, then you need to be in a place enough to be able to bring something out of it. In 6 months, you should decide whether this is the place where you're going to learn and grow, and then maybe at least a 5-year spectrum. So I think that's the trends that are coming out today, that whether it's management or whether it's how much is degrees? Because 50% of our education market had a problem where degrees was more something you needed to put on your CV, of which 50% was used for your marriage market, whether we like it or not, unfortunately. All of that, I think, is going away because people are realizing they need to perform in a competitive environment. That is the biggest trend.
From a commercial viability point of view, where does UpGrad stand? Given that IIT Bombay, for instance, has spoken language tutorials on mass market courses, and then that's probably at the lower end of the spectrum. Then you have courses offered by Udacity or course around the higher end of the spectrum. These are free, and these are also they've got an IIT League badging. So, in that sense, where do you see for-profit online education ventures standing?
Yeah, so I'll first answer Udacity and Coursera. Great companies, free content. It's content and not the learning experience. If you go back and you can test their models and where they stand between their last fundraise and now, they're already having their own challenges, because primarily, I would say that their completion records for people completing a course, for anyone here who's done a Coursera course, you may have done two or three, but how many did you complete? And the ratio will be very less. It'll be like their statistics is 5 to 7%. At UpGrad, we are hand-holding and we spend 40% of our money not on marketing and content, but on the learning experience. The mentorship program where any week you haven't logged on, we are calling your spouse or your daughter or your father or your mother and telling them what you missed out on that. And there's an incredible amount. Not in a sales way, but just an involvement way. Second, from a cost, that was one. The second, from a cost perspective, I think even if a course is an average about 2.5 lakhs rupees, which for most people think, are, that's very expensive. But an offline course of that same equivalent is double the cost. Plus, your lodging and boarding to move to the place of that offline place is another 1x. And there's another 3x of opportunity cost of moving out of a job for a year to take a break to study, if you are not a student. So I would say we're 1/8 the cost of everybody else for, if you understand that online is the only way to go. And that's our investment in online, I mean, in learning experience, and a cost which we think is much less in terms of opportunity cost. So for example, even when people in the middle of their job, they have to take 6 months off to even do a refresher course. You're not sure whether you're going to come back and do a job. You have to start all over again at the bottom of the ladder.
And are there specific courses that are seeing traction?
So today for us, we focused more on the what we call careers of tomorrow, which is data, digital, machine learning, artificial intelligence. And that's really caught on. Data science and data analytics being the one where we've really found an incredible amount of push. But I think today when we're looking at our MBAs in elements outside of marketing and HR, which is those are also catching. So, and I think more and more people want to learn in less and less time. And I think the 2-year MBA is becoming a 15-month MBA. Because at the end of the day, 2 years is you're blocking 2 years of your life. But I can, in an online environment, between the time, the break, the whatever else, the summer training, all of that can happen. Because summer training can be replaced with you're on the job, you're running.
I would want to talk to you about your venture in sports. You're part of the Kabaddi League. You almost created a new sport there, like how television, Kabaddi came on television. You also, I'm sure, followed the franchise model most sports are going to. Is it a sustainable model? And even for Kabaddi or for say other sports which are on television, do you think it's too much of almost like a soap opera kind of the way they're presented, the backstories, the whole drama, the emotions on the players' faces, the whole element of sport, is it disappearing?
So maybe I'll answer the sport question with 2-3 matters. One, I think there's too little sport in India. Two, we're never going to win Olympic gold medals in this country ever unless we start at a much younger age. And all of us in this room believe that sports is a career option and not a hobby. Third, we have only one sport in this country right now, and that's cricket. And literally the whole world has moved on from cricket. We went from world cricket to then Commonwealth countries. From Commonwealth countries, everyone's got a second, third, fourth and fifth sport. We're the only one that has. Today, 90% of all revenues of cricket worldwide comes from India. So if you look at that, it's a contracting base. So thank God that we are now opening it up to a certain level. So that's one aspect of sport. And if genuinely, outside of winning a war with our neighboring country, there is no other better national pride than for us to be winning gold medals at the Olympics or winning a World Cup in different sports. I think it brings a nation together, brings a strong sense of national pride. Even more than becoming a 5 trillion economy when we celebrate that will be if we have 20 golds. I think, or at least equivalent to that. So that's why I think it's a very strong sense of our overall sense of pride and ecosystem within the country. Therefore, this is a mini step in terms of leagues. I mean, coming to Kabaddi, yes, cricket without television would not be cricket. Cricket with 5-day test matches would not be cricket. So taking 5 days to 1 day, 1 day to 50 overs, 50 overs to 20 overs is drama. It's drama. It's shortening. It's a little bit like I said about the learning experience today. You do want to take on something and start understanding most, but tell me in a shorter period of time. Now, don't take so much time doing that. So there is a sense when you're taking a sport and you want to evangelize it, you have to build a certain what you call drama. But I'm saying if we took a Kabaddi sport, for example, that is in the Asian Games, it's a 40-minute sport there, but there's no do or die round, which is there that we introduced there. There's no bonus. That means two teams can go, come back, go, come back, and the maximum score is 7-6. Here, the minimum score is 25-25, which means that in that 40 minutes, there's so much of excitement that once you hook onto that sport, it's very difficult to put the TV off because it's a never-ending 40-minute experience. It's one of the shorter sports we have with a lot of action. 30% is the female viewership in Kabaddi today. And that's partly because the men are dressed in tight costumes. Now we've worked on them to make them look hot. We've taken it out from being, imagine if it was on the matti versus the mat. Nobody would be seeing it because in 2 minutes they'd be filthy and then you say, what the hell is this sport that I'm watching? So yeah, we have to do drama. I mean, everything is about that.